correct? And then he came from to remove free from the world system, and then he came for remove us from the legalistic world, the legalistic view, and dead works. But today there is one more truth is there why Jesus came. So that's what we're going to see today. Okay, so that's one biblical truth which is really a revelation for me. So I just want to it's spirit led. I just want to reveal to you through the spirit. We all know from starting of the Bible till Genesis, till the back, God has one view about man, one desire about man is he wants man to look like him. He wants a man to be look like him. Bible says God created man on his own image, right? So he want a man to be looking like him. Okay, meaning how God Jesus looks, how God looks. He wants a man to be looked. That's the only purpose of creating a man. If you read the verse clearly, right, in the whole universe, not even the angels, if you read the verse clearly, he did not say, I create a servant, I create a gardener. He did not say that one. I create a man on my own image. Because God's desire in us is to reflect him. So we have to always reflect his image. The one thing that impacts us not to reflect the image is sin. Right? Sin is the major thing that hinders us. Adam fall on the sin. He listened to the devil's voice, so he fall and he left the glory. Okay. So man's biggest trouble is sin. So how we saw various version. We had a services too where we saw that how to free from the sin, right? How to live a life freely from the sin. So we saw it. But one thing today we're going to see the importance of sin. Important, the seriousness of sin. Okay. Let me give an example then, so that it stands in your mind if you read it, okay? If you read 1 John chapter 3 verse 4, it talks about that if you not obey law, it's sin. Okay, if you do not obey the law, it's sin. Okay, 1 John chapter 3 verse 4. In James chapter 4 verse 17, it says that if you do not do a thing which you are supposed to do, it is a sin. Okay, I'm categorizing the sin as two types, okay? One sin is that you should not do, you are doing it. There is another type of sin is you are supposed to do one thing but you are not doing it. That is a sin. Okay? I can give you an example. Okay? Obey your parents. Honor your parents. Is a commandment, right? So you have to do that. If you do not do it, it's sin. Another thing is do not commit adultery. So if that is you should not do it, but if you do it, right? So that is also a sin. So there are two extremes out there. You are categorizing the sin in two ways. Okay. There is one more verse in Hebrews which says, Hebrews chapter 3 verse 13. It talks about encouraging each other. Can anyone take and read verse Hebrews chapter 3 verse 13? It talks about encouraging each other. But that's not my whole topic. That you can take it as a reference. Okay. It talks about encourage each other some days.
No, but encourage one another daily.
Daily.
As long as it is today.
Amen. So this verse is saying, encourage one another daily. Okay, keep this verse in your mind. Okay, I'll put a simple example. You know this word that we have to encourage each other. Check up your life today. Okay, I'm not talking about encouraging others. Leave it. Whom do you see daily? Whom do you see with daily on face that you see daily? Whom is it?
Family.
Your wife.
Family.
Right? So, did we encourage her daily? Did we encourage her daily? We know that. Leave about going other side and encouraging others. Leave about it. It's about the wife and the wife to husband also the same. It's not the verse referred to one particular husband, no? It's referred to both husband and wife. So, wife should encourage husband should encourage wife. So, in one day if you missed it, any day you went to prayer, by the end of the day, did you go and pray, Lord, I missed encouraging my wife. We never say that one, right? But I miss my duty. That's a sin. If you think on that, right? Whole years I did a sin, but I didn't know it, right? I missed it. So the seriousness of sin is very important. See, overcoming sin, right? We saw various ways to overcome sin. One more way is to overcome sin is if you know the consequence of sin. If you know the seriousness of sin, what will happen to me when sin comes to my life? If you understand the importance, then you will not do sin, right? That is the only way to overcome. There is no another magic or something is there. But you need to know the consequence of sin. happen to me, then only you won't do it. Simple example, Kiran is playing and I'll say like, don't go touch the fire, it will harm you. Okay? That's same like sin. But until he touches and feels that and feels the seriousness, he won't do it, right? So if you know the seriousness, you won't do it. What will happen to your life? That's what today we're going to see. What will happen in a sin, when sin comes upon your life, right? What will happen to it? I just want to go through a person's life in Bible. When you read that person's life, when the sin came upon, what happened? That's what we're going to see. There is also one more explanation I want to give it. Actually, I want to show it in a video is there. I want to show it, but I don't know how many of you like the video, so I don't want to show that video, but you can go ahead and watch. There is an experiment done by a scientist, okay? What they did is they took a frog and they kept a vessel in the stove and they put a water inside it and they raised the temperature. So the water got boiled and they measured the temperature. Okay, it was very high temperature, so they put the frog inside that pond. Immediately the frog jumped and came out. Okay? And then one more experiment what they did is in cold water they put the frog inside it and they slowly raised the temperature of the frog, temperature of the water. So it slowly moved it. Till the temperature came, it didn't even move, it just started moving, it jumped out. Once the temperature raised above that, it could not able to come out, it dead. You can go over and see it, it's there in the YouTube. It says the experiment with the boiling water, frog experiment in the boiling water. Same in our life, slowly the Satan blinds our eyes such a way that the sin, we don't think it is a sin at all. It comes in our mind, it will make a mind or thought, it will be there. When the punishment of the sin comes upon, then you will feel like, oh my God, I did this. We cannot come out of it. You cannot come out because you are already dipped into that one. Slowly, Satan do not put you directly on that. He blinds us and he puts the sin slowly into it, making you not that it is sin at all. He will say that is not sin at all. Leave about the biggest sin. He will make you such a way that is not sin at all. No one might have thought that encouraging my wife is a sin, right? Today, unless we saw the verse. Encouraging one another. Similarly, Satan blinds our eyes such a way that it shows like it's not sin at all. And we do that things. And we miss the blessing of God. We have to understand the importance of that. Today I just want to go and see a life of a person. What happened in his life? What is the seriousness of the sin and how we can come out of it? Okay. The Bible has various books. There is one book which talks about, the whole book talks about how a baby is getting born, meaning conceived in the womb, and how it got delivered. That's how, meaning how it get grows and get delivered from the womb. This is the whole structure of that particular book. Any guess of that book? Any guess which book it is? The whole book talks about how a baby is getting conceived in the womb and get delivered. So that's what it talks about, the whole book, the context of the book. Any guess? Exodus is the book. It talks about how God's nation being conceived in the womb of Egypt and it grows 10 months and gets delivered from God's hand. That's the book. I think you have to read every Bible in your, if you read a book, you have a synopsis, meaning synopsis in the book, the whole Bible talks about. If you, each book, in top of it, there is a paragraph will be there. Before the start of, you have to read that. That will give you a context of the book. It will give easily. So today we're going to see about Exodus chapter 3. It's a known person. You might have known that person, but I want to say one truth about it. Exodus chapter 3, verse 1 to 4.
Side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see the strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called him from within the bush.
Amen.
Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am.
Amen. This is the famous incident that happens in the Moses' life, right? It's a God's encounter with a person. Everyone might have idea about this particular moment, right? Where Jesus comes, God comes and appears to Moses and talks to him. This incident. So, God is going to speak to, God has revealed this particular verse to me. If you read Exodus chapter 1 and 2, the history behind it, before taking any verse, you have to know the history background behind the verses, or else you will miss the context. Okay, so don't go by there is a verse so I can take it as a promise. You should not do that. Okay, there is a verse in Bible so that can be meant to know. There is the verse has to be checked to whom it is being addressed, on what situation it is being addressed, that situation matches my situation, then you can take it as a promise. Please be very clear on that. It's very important that when we follow Bible as a Christian, when we walk, we should know that. So when a verse is being given, you need to know the history and background and what situation that verse occurs. So I will just give a small introduction on the Exodus chapter 1 and 2. Okay, Genesis chapter ends up with Joseph. Okay, Genesis chapter ends up with Joseph. And Joseph comes and Joseph's family comes and stays, generation comes and stays in Egypt. And they get grow more. If you see that the Joseph being that particular Egypt, they grow, the generations grow more. And after a couple of generations, Joseph passed away and his generation passed away. A king comes in, the Egypt king comes in, where he does not know about Joseph at all. Okay, at that moment, the Hebrews grow more, meaning the God's people got more on that particular Egypt than the Egyptian people. So what they do, they got scared. How come in their nation other people can grow? And they does not know what Joseph did it. The previous king knows, right? The king, for example, if Joseph assumed like Jeevan is the king, and Ratnana helped him at that moment. So Jeevan allowed to stay, Jeevan along with him. Okay? And after he passed away, another king comes in. So but he does not know what the help has done. So he missed the part. He doesn't know what happened. But the people who stayed in the particular Egypt, they grow more. So they got scared. How come these people get more? Then we'll become slave to them. So they started mistreating the people who stay there, Israel people. So Egypt starts mistreat the people. So what he passes a law, the king's name is Pharaoh, who comes up, he passes a law in stating that you should kill all the babies, the boy babies, to put in the Nile. So that is a law got passed on so that the Israel people will reduce, the population will get reduced and they can rule over them. So that's the situation at that moment. So here you have to look at two perspectives so that you can understand this one. What God wants to do at this moment? In this moment, God, these are God's chosen people. God promises to Abraham, I will lead you to the places. So God has selected these people, He has brought them. He has a fixed time to get the people out of this place and take it to a promised land where they can enjoy the fruitful. So he chooses a person to do that. Okay, he is not an ordinary person. If you read, he is not an ordinary person. He is very good leader. Okay, he has all the power of a king. How a king should be, he has so much of power. He chooses a person. Okay, and he wants through that person to get delivered. If you read Isaiah chapter 63 verse 12, it says out of his hand he led the people. You can read Isaiah chapter 63 12. How powerful his hand was. It talks about how powerful his hand was. Moses' hand.
Who led them by the right hand of Moses with his glorious arm, dividing the water before them.
Amen.
To make for himself an everlasting name.
Amen. God always requires a hand, okay, to do his thing. They have to raise his hand. Moses has to lift his hand. But the work has been done by Jesus. We are very clear on that, okay? But he depends upon the Moses' hands to get lifted up. Many times what happens is that I prayed a thing happened. I prayed he got healed. It's totally wrong. You need to just open up a hand, but the work is done by Jesus. You have to be very clear on that. You are not doing anything at all. But in order for the miracle to happen, you need to raise a hand. You need to know when you need to open the raise the hand. So you have to be very clear. Man, many times what they do, they go and pray or they go and pray something and they will say, take the glory to themselves. I prayed it, she got healed. I did this, she got it. No. It's the work is done by Jesus Christ. You have to be very clear on that. No person can take glory on it. But you have to, God needs a person to raise a hand. He is always dependent on that to reveal his glory. Okay? Here Moses, he selects a person, Moses. Okay? The circumstance at that moment is not favorable at all. Because the law in that moment is no boy baby can be there. Right? They ask him to throw into the Nile River if a boy baby is born. At that moment, what God does it is, he makes a baby to go in the coat of Aaron. Everyone knows that, right? So, everyone knows the history of Moses. You want me to read the verses? Everyone was very silent, right? So, so God made the baby to grow in the Pharaoh's court. One more thing I want to highlight here is that even though there is a law against it, whatever may be the law, if God is determined to do things, then no man can stop it. Whatever may be the situation, it can be whomever may be the king. But whatever the law that comes again, if God determined to do it, he will do it. Whatever may be the purpose. See, he made the baby to grow in the Pharaoh's court itself. And the God's desire is, he wants to, through Moses, he wants to take the people out of Egypt and take it to the promised land. This is the God's desire. Okay? Now I want to talk about the Moses view. Who Moses was? What kind of a person he is? So anyone can explain how Moses was? Anyone can explain a Moses' characteristics? You might have known, this is a well-known character of Moses, right? Everyone knows the character of Moses. You can illustration what kind of a person he is based upon your view. What kind of a person? He's a good leader, you can say, because he led the people for 40 years, not small crowd, 10 people. He led 32 lakhs people from one nation to another big nation. It's not a simple thing. So we can say him as a leader, right? So what more characteristics you can give him? Any more? Any characters?
He actually built up his faith over the period. Like when he initially started, he doesn't know. He thinks he's not the right person to go there. But then when God said, you are the person and I'll give you help, then he built up the faith by the end of the journey, right? By the end of it, he came so close to God that he actually wanted to see him face to face, and even when he was a human being. So that's the kind of faith he's a
faithful person.
He has a very faithful, faith building
person. Okay. I just want to go over each characteristics on it. If you read the education of Moses, it's Acts chapter 7 verse 22. If you read the verse, Acts chapter 7 verse 22. In Tamil also I want to read that particular verse, it's very nice on Tamil.
Moses was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians. Amen. And was powerful in speech and action.
Amen. Acts chapter 7 verse 22. And Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptian and was mighty in words and deeds. Egypt is the country at that moment was highest in the civilization. They were the topmost kind of education institute was there. So he was well versed in everything. He was a well versed person. He was not a normal person at all. We can give his a doctorate to him. But in India, they are giving doctorate to even senior actors, so I don't want to give to him, that's a doctorate. So we can give it towards the highest qualification, because Egypt was that kind of civilized person. He was not even brought in a small house, he is brought in a biggest king's court. So he has been trained in all the education, all type of skills he has procured. He is not a very normal person, it says a well-versed person. Can anyone read in Tamil? It is very nice in Tamil too, and Telugu also.
மோசே ஏத்தனுடைய சகல சாஸ்திரங்களிலும் கற்பிக்கப்பட்டு வாக்கிலும் செயலும்
வல்லவனானார். He has become well versed in everything. வாக்கிலும் செயலையும் வல்லவனானார். In all things. He didn't say few things. No. At that moment when Egypt, whatever all the training that they had, he was well versed in everything. So you can give us a very big scholar, a doctor, to him, Moses. So that's one character. Leader one we saw it. Another character is what we saw it as in a doctorate kind of a award we can give it to him. One more characteristics which I saw, it is Revelation chapter 15 verse 2 and 3. Revelation chapter 15. Realizing that he is not part of the Egyptian community, when he was growing in the palace, he saw that this is not my brothers, Hebrew meaning Israel's are my brother, so he has a heart in it. So one day come to a pass where he saw his people are being mistreated, okay, his people are being enslaved, they are being tortured, okay, he saw that, and what he does that, even though he was brought and brought up in the court, and also if you read the verse, it says the Hebrew men only brought up in initial stage. They might have told him that a savior is going to come and save these people. There is a promise also is there. So he knows that there is a savior is going to come. And he knows that God has fixed a time to bring him out. But what he does is he takes everything in his hand. God was supposed to come and deliver him. He acted 10 years before what God appointed him. God has a time for him to stand up and then you have to take it. But 10 years before that, what he thought was, even though his intention was to do good, to save that person, but he thought, I can deliver him by my own thing, own strength. That is a sin that he did. He thought, I can save him. He took everything on his own and he judged it and he killed it. Okay? That is the biggest sin that he did. He didn't wait for God to do things to him. That's the one biggest sin. He took, his intention was right. Okay, to save him, but he took the power on his own. I can deliver it instead of waiting for God to do it. He judged on his own that particular person and he killed that particular person. Okay, what happens in the next is the verse, you can see it. And when he went out, verse 13, and he went out the second day, behold, two Hebrew men were fighting. And he said to the one who did the wrong, why are you striking your companion? Okay. Then he said, who made you to prince and judge over us? Okay. Do you intend to kill me as you killed the Egyptian? So Moses feared. Okay. The next day comes. Okay. There is a two friends are fighting. Moses goes and talks to them. And he says, who are you to judge me? Are you the prince? Are you trying to kill me like what you did yesterday? What he did hidden, it came to visible the next day. Okay. Many times the sin that we do, you might not know that others might have not seen it. But it will come to, when it comes to outside to the light of everyone, then you have, first thing comes in your mind is fear. If you read the next verse, the verse it says he got feared. So Moses feared. When the sin is brought into light, the first thing comes into you is fear. Very, very clear on that one. When a sin comes to bright, you might have thought that sin cannot overcome me. A sin does not have any power, but sin is not like that. It will leave. It cannot leave you. It will not leave you until unless it makes a punishment. Until unless you go to God and get delivered. Okay. So the sin, you might be thinking like no one might have seen my sin. I deleted my cookies, so no one can see the sin that I did by watching the pornography, something like that. But it will come to light one day. At that moment, you will receive that one. But in order for you to save, you have to go to God to get that clean. Right? So very clear that when a sin comes upon a person, okay, and it comes to a light, the first thing comes is the fear. Then what he did is, then he said, verse 14. Sorry, verse 15. When Pharaoh heard of this matter, he sought to kill Moses. But Moses fled from the face of Pharaoh and dwelt in the land of Midian, and he sat down by a well. Verse 16. Now the priest of Midian and 7 daughters came, and they came and drew water, and they filled the trough to water with their father's flock. We go on reading it, he runs away to the Midian and he tends the flock and he's been a shepherd, okay, and he's been there in that year, there in the Midianite, okay. You can separate the Moses life into 40 years, 340 years, okay. The first early life in the Pharaoh's court, 40 years. The second 40 years is the years where he's being a shepherd. The next 40 years is where he leads the people. So totally 120 years is what Moses hears. So, Here you see it, Moses runs away because of the sin, okay, that got visible. When sin comes into your life, it separates you from God's doing things. It is determined that he has to be there at that particular moment. God has a big plan on him, okay? God has a big plan on him, but he has to be there at that particular time, but he was not there. Why? Because he took everything on his own to deliver his people. Okay, so he ran away out of him. So God, when you do sin, right, fear comes in. Second thing, you'll be getting far away from the God's will, doing what God has to do. So that's the separation that will happen to you when a sin comes upon your life. Okay? But in that moment, right, he was away from God. He was a well-educated person, okay? He was good in scholar and everything. He was very good in poet and everything. He was a very good leader. But a sin comes upon him. See what happens in his life. He has a great big job. A big nation has to be delivered from one particular place to other place. Okay? Asim, leave about the story and everything, okay? Take Ratnana as there, okay? And God has assigned him this big job. If he knows that one, how he will feel? Oh my God, he trusted me so many big job to deliver it, but I am not able to deliver it because of my sin. Or in other words, Asim Jeevan is there, a big project is given to him, okay, which is going to deliver the whole particular America because of that particular project, and he was out of it because the sin that he did it. How much might be he might have felt? Thus 40 years when he was there in the, meaning when he was tending his flocks, he might have thought, how educated I am, how I am supposed to deliver people, because of my sin I got far away. 40 years he might have felt, daily he might have felt, it's because of my sin. Because I took everything on my own hand. Every day when he was tending his flocks, he might have thought in his mind, oh Lord, how I am supposed to be. So he was a dejected man, or you can say it is a failure person. You can say it is a failed person. Right? So God comes and meet him on that after the 40 years and talks to him on that burning bush. That's what happened. Okay? Even though he is a failed person, even though he did a sin, okay, but God comes and talks to him and he says to him that, my son, the place that while you're standing is holy, okay, and he takes him back and he puts him back to do the will of God. See your heart of Jesus. Even though we commit sin and we fall away from the glory of God, but our heart, our God's heart is that he comes and gives a grace to us to lift us up from the sin and puts in the will back again and do his will. But there was a 40 years of delay was there. It's because of that. The very important thing you have to understand is Moses has to be there in 400 years on that 400th year at that moment for Jesus to start, God to start his action. But he acted 390 years before itself, 10 years before itself. Because of that, the people of Israel has to get, meaning go through the tough path for 30 years. How difficult it is. How the big consequence it is. We have to understand the importance of it. Right? A sin can separate us from God and also make us to not do the will of God at the right moment on his time. So we have to understand the seriousness of sin in our life. Very important that sin is very, Bible says in Romans chapter 6 verse 23, the wages of sin is death. Pavatin sambalam maranam. You will have to, without God you cannot suffer. See, in your life right now, you might be thinking like, okay, I have given my life that to Jesus, one day I prayed, that's it. I am a saved person. And if you don't take the sin serious in your life, you will get fall. Because slowly the sin gets added up in your life and you will be far off from God. Okay? Jesus came to make, the main purpose of the Jesus came to earth is to show where you are. That's the first thing. And then to deliver him and restore him. That's what Jesus did. The first thing that his action was to show him where you are. Where you are far away from God. How far away from God? One sin, okay, you go 1 centimeter. One more sin, you go far away. One more sin comes upon you, you go far away. You will be very far away from God, which you might not even, you might thought like, okay, I'm closer to God, but you might be very far away from God. When Jesus comes and stands only, you will know, oh my God, I was so far away because of the sins that, each sin that I did in my life. Okay? So Jesus came to earth just to, not to deliver you from sin. He also came to show you where you are and then to take you out of sin and save you. That's the main important thing in our life. No one likes to be, meaning naked, right? No one likes to be naked. That's a simple thing, right? God, once you redeemed you, this is when you bought you from the sin by the blood sacrifice, He covered you with His holiness, right? With His holiness, He covers you. Many times when we go out, if our pants or dress gets loose, we immediately adjust it, right? But how many times we felt awakened in our heart that if I see a woman, okay, my holiness dress goes away. We never felt like that. We never even felt that my spiritual garment has been gone. We never think right. Because we give so much importance to the worldly thing, not the spiritual thing. You never knew that I was covered with a spiritual garment, the holiness, so that I reflect the image of God. But we'll be very sorrowful if one shirt or something, it goes away, we adjust immediately so that it doesn't show off. But if I commit a sin like looking at a woman, oh my God, I should be very careful, I should not look at it because I am holy. I should be holy so that I can reflect image of God. That is the awakening that we need to have in our mind when we walk in the spirit. Okay? So that's the only way, one more way to overcome sin in your life. Understanding the importance of sin makes you to overcome sin. Okay? So that's one thing that the Holy Spirit wants to say to you. Because Moses was a well-educated person. Okay? Even though he's educated, education will show you as if you can become a normal, meaning a gentle person. But education cannot make you perfect before stand in front of God. You can be well-versed or educated, scholar person. But that cannot make you go and stand right with God. It cannot make you. Only God, Jesus, can make you to be right with God. Okay? You have to be very clear. So, if you think you didn't even consider a sin. Okay, I was not so serious about sin. If you close your eyes, you rededicate your life towards God now. Okay, Lord, I want to rededicate my life towards to you. That I should be more cautious about my spiritual walk with you so that I can show your image. I should be more cautious and understand the seriousness of sin. And more than that, we should be very careful listening to Him, what He needs to do, what time He needs to do. It's very important in our spiritual walk with God. So let's close our eyes. Stotram, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We are not gathered here just for a gathering, just to have a time pass time, or just like a fellowship to talk to each other. Hear about God, and if there is anything wrong inside in us which needs to be corrected, we have to get corrected. Okay? Holy Spirit is given to you to find the fault in you, not others. Please be very careful. Okay? The Holy Spirit comes upon you to correct you.
Amen.
This is very important. In every day of your life, if you are not finding fault in your life, that means go to God. You are not gone to God at all. Okay? Just be very clear on that. Lord, just correct me what I did wrong today. Did there is any words or my actions was incorrect, O Lord? Is there something which is did what I did was which was not pleasing to you, Lord? Please correct me, O Lord. You can ask it. Please understand that. Every day you come and singing a song, Lord, I want to do my will of God. That's not going to make you spiritual. Until unless you know the will of God, if you go ahead and read the verse, it clearly says God has created you as an image of God to, because He wants you to look like Him. Very important word, very important, my brother. So you, in your life, are you reflecting Him? Are we reflecting Him in your words or in your action? Even treating your wife, even the way you talk, even the way we speak. It's very important. It's a moment between you and God. Don't act and don't pretend. You are not trying to cheat me. It's you be serious. Okay, my brother, I really want to say that one. It's be really, really serious. God is very serious about sin. If you go ahead and read Matthew chapter 18, you know how Jesus dealt with the sin. Jesus says that that person can tie their neck with a rope and tie the other end with a big stone and throw it in the deep sea. If a person is trying to cause another person a sin. That's the what God's verse is. You can go ahead and read Matthew chapter verse 18 is there. It's very important that even your action should not make others to sin, which is very important. If you did that, correct yourself today. Close your eyes and ask, Lord, is the way I dress is tempting to others, or is the way I speak is causing others to sin, which is very important, Lord. I should not make others also to fall in sin, which is also very important. You should not sin and you should not make others to also sin, which is very important. Stotra Mandavare, Lord Jesus, hallelujah. Stotra Mandavare, Stotra. If you want to rededicate oneself, Lord, I just want to submit to you once again, O Lord, that my life completely surrender unto you, Lord. Give me the strength to overcome, O Lord Jesus. Till date, I was not so serious about my sin or the walk of my life. Lord, starting today, O Lord Jesus, starting now, I just want to reflect you, O Lord Jesus, in every ways of my life, O Lord, in every path, every steps, O Lord, that I take, O Lord Jesus. I just want to reflect you. I just want to show you, O Lord Jesus. Like Moses, God has a big plan for each one of us. Like each plan for Jeevan or Moses or Joseph, everyone has a big plan for your life. God has brought you for that plan to get fulfilled. Stotram Andavare, Stotram. Lord, let's be more listen to you, Lord. Let our ears be more tend to you, Lord Master Eddie. Listen to you, Lord Jesus. Each and every action, O Lord, Lord Master Eddie, speak to us, O Lord. Even in the office, O Lord, give us the right knowledge and wisdom to speak which word we have to speak, O Lord. Stotram Andavare, Stotram. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Stotram, Stotram, O Lord. Lord, let the Holy Spirit take more control of us, O Lord Jesus. Never in our life we should take things in our own hand, O Lord Master Eddie, and judge people, O Lord. Lord, you be with us, O Lord. Let your Spirit lead us in every moment, O Lord Master Eddie. Be with us, O Lord. Continuously speak to us, O Lord Jesus. We ask this prayer in the presence of Lord Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.